Hey everybody, Retro Roger here with warm holiday wishes and a new project video for you. In my recent channel rebranding video, I committed to being the host of this channel. Historically, I've preferred to stay behind the scenes, choosing voice narration over images and video. When I thought about it though, I realized I enjoy getting to know the people behind my favorite channels. So, get ready to see more of me in the upcoming videos. I hope you enjoy getting to know me too. To achieve my goal of appearing on camera more, I decided to learn more about using OBS Studio. I've used it before to capture content for my videos, but that was about it. I found it challenging to use, so I never really scratched the surface of what it can do. After my channel rebranding, I watched some tutorials, and this is when I learned about something called a Stream Deck, a device with buttons and knobs to control different aspects of OBS Studio. The new project in today's video is about building the open source FreeDeck Stream Deck. What makes it unique is the use of small OLED displays that function as buttons by placing a small micro switch beneath the display. Using the FreeDeck Configurator application, the displays can be programmed to show icons and text labels and do different things when you tap or hold them. By the way, I am using OBS to record this, and my FreeDeck just switched to this scene. You'll find the link to the GitHub repository for this project down in the description. There you'll find the files for ordering PCBs, a parts list, software for microcontrollers like Arduino Micro or Raspberry Pi Pico, and the Configurator application for programming your FreeDeck, or you can even use the web UI version. I chose to build the Pico version to get some experience using a Pico. I ordered the minimum batch of 5 PCBs from JLCPCB and sourced the parts to assemble them all. Due to components being on both sides of the PCB, the build order is important. In my excitement, I got the build order wrong on the first board, complicating the assembly unnecessarily. Here in this video, I'm assembling the second board, leveraging the experience gained from the initial assembly. Okay, well, on with the build video. What I'm doing right now is applying solder paste to the pads, and I'm using my tweezers to kind of help it stick on there. And now we're going to go ahead and put the switches down. If you get the right amount of solder paste, it really makes your work a lot easier. Not using a solder mask, you tend to have a little extra solder, and you'll see all these little solder balls. I'll be cleaning those up in just a moment. I like the way they kind of snap into position. So here's just a Q-tip swab with some alcohol on it. The end of the stick is actually kind of helpful for scrubbing away the balls, and then the Q-tip obviously holds the alcohol for you. Checking to make sure all the switches work with the meter, and installing the reset switch on the other side of the board. On this one, I started cleaning it before it was cooled off enough, and it jumped off, so I reheated it back up. Get it all cleaned up. Make sure it works. Alright, so now these are the sockets for the Pi. And the way I like to do these long header pins is just to do the corners. And then you can check the alignment, and it's really easy to just heat up one of the corners and wiggle them around to get the alignment that you want. And this is where I went wrong the first time. Right now you can see me straightening out the pins on the micro SD card, but the first time around I actually soldered the Arduino or the Raspberry Pi Pico in at this point, and it made installing the OLED displays a little more difficult, but You see, this time around it went a lot easier. I discovered I didn't solder the rest of the pins at that point and went back in there and touched them all up. Sorry for the glare. I was using a headlamp with a magnifier on it, and from my perspective, I didn't see that light glaring on the board. The lamp's adjustable, so I'll see if I can adjust it so that it doesn't show up so much. More cleaning, and the paper towel and the swabs leave debris on there, but that acid brush does a really good job of cleaning it off. And again, I'm just using regular IPA to clean the flux away. Okay. I rhymed. I really didn't like that Saint Smart tool that I'm using with the pins. It's also got some alligator clips on flexible things, and those don't work so well. But those pins are really nice for when you have to flip the board over frequently. When I install the sockets, I bend the opposite corners, and then I tack the other opposite corners down first. Make sure it's seated using that same technique of heating them up and pushing it down if I need to. But you saw me there unbend the two legs that I'd bent over, and if I ever have to unsolder that socket, I'll be glad that those two legs aren't bent over. More cleaning. I'm using the foam off of one of the OLED displays, and it's a convenient way to capture the little legs so they don't go flying everywhere. And here we go, finally putting in the first display. If you had your Pico in there at that point, you'd have a problem. I jumped ahead there a little bit. I'm doing a lot of fiddling around with adjusting it off the camera, and I actually get better at it and don't have to fiddle with them so much as I progress here, but I'll get better at that and try to keep that kind of stuff on camera. Keep that in mind when I'm doing these build videos. Yeah, it was a little tight getting in there, but not too bad. Just had to go slow and be careful. You'll see quite often I'm using like my pinky to anchor or just anchoring somewhere, and that helps you be a lot more stable. Alright, clean those up. I did not solder those pins on the micro SD adapter, so I guess I decided not to clean them off. Here goes the Pico. See how easy that was? Just flip it around, do the next side. Those magnets are really strong too. I like that. Okay, so we're putting the chips in. In the next video, I'll install the firmware onto the Pico, 3D print a case, and assemble a completed unit. After that, I'll demonstrate using the Configurator application to program the FreeDeck. This series will end with what I've learned about using the FreeDeck with OBS. Thank you for your interest in this content. Let me know how I'm doing down in the comments. You can help me get the word out by liking and sharing this video. If you haven't already, hit that subscribe button and ring the notification bell. Retro Roger signing off for now, but stay tuned for more incredible content celebrating the nostalgic allure of vintage technology.